not 4 months old, each side losing thousands again, both to bullets and that silent common enemy, influenza. Between the opposing trenches was an area about the width of a football field, no man's land. Littered with barbed wire and frozen corpses, it was a sobering reminder of what the future might bring. Soldiers who survived later recalled their brothers being scattered up, stacked like cords of wood. At war's end, more than 10 million would be lost. Not surprisingly, given the circumstances, most of the soldiers were religious, and many were Christian. On Sundays, communion was passed in the trenches, on both sides, often to the sound of church bells ringing in the nearby villages. The occasional hymn was sung, and youthful voices were heard across enemy lines. By December, the war slowed, and hopes for a quick resolution faded away as the soldiers contemplated their desperate situation. Nights grew long, and the hearts yearned for peace. The Christmas truce of 1914 is one of the most extraordinary incidents of World War I, and of all military history. Starting in some places on Christmas Eve and others on Christmas Day, the truce be covered as much as two-thirds of the British Army, German front. With thousands of soldiers taking part, perhaps most remarkably, it grew out of a single mission, but sprang up each place spontaneously and independently. Nearly everything described here is drawn from first-hand accounts in letters and diaries of the time.
Christmas Day, 1914. Dear Mother,
my darling Meg,
my good friend Charles,
my dear sister Janet.
It is 2 a.m, and most of our men are asleep in their dugouts.
Yet I could not sleep myself before writing to you the wonderful events of Christmas Eve.
In truth, what happened seemed almost like a fairy tale, and if I hadn't been through it myself,